that good? All right, cool. I don't want to deafen anyone. All right. So if everyone's ready to get started. So this is a talk about TOR, anonymity, and censorship. I completely forgot to put TOR in the title, but it's on the website, so I got it half right. So a little bit about me. I'm a computer science major at Iowa. I spent a summer in an IoT device lab doing pen testing at Underwriters Laboratories, so like Wi-Fi routers, thermostats, stuff like that. Spent a summer as an IT admin, never again. And I've been working at ProCircular for almost 2 years now as an intern doing pen tests. Yeah, I wasn't sure. We're like right between. So the scope of this talk, we're going to talk about, we're going to define anonymity and censorship, some incentives for achieving and preventing both of them, some methods of achieving and defeating anonymity, and some implementations and circumventions of censorship. And then we'll kind of weave in TOR with all of this, how it achieves some of these goals with these concepts. So just a quick acknowledgement. Professor Rishabh Nithyanand, he's pretty new at the university, but I learned a lot of this stuff from him. He's a really passionate TOR and anonymity advocate. I stole some graphics from him because he told me it was cool. And if you're looking for an academic resource in security, I would definitely contact him. So a quick definition of anonymity. So anonymity is just being indistinguishable from peers, or you're unlinkable to your activity. So if it's possible to link your traffic with a profile, it's fine as long as that profile isn't associated with you, and it's not possible to associate it with you. And you kind of measure anonymity in a set. So if you have 300 people, then the odds of you being identified is 1 in 300, assuming that the adversary can't pick better than random chance. So kind of the goal with TOR, your set is just all TOR users. And since this is a large enough set, then TOR has become secure. But if, as we'll see later, if you use a small set, like if your roommate pirates a movie, then it's like one of two people who could have done that. And I know this because I got billed for it. So why would we want anonymity? This is InfoSec community, so I'm sure everyone's already very aware of this and has their own opinions on it. But privacy is a right. It's not okay for me to just barge into your house, so I shouldn't be able to barge into your packets. Avoiding targeting by advertisers. I don't know if anyone remembers when I think targeted advertising told somebody they were pregnant before they knew they were. It's kind of Orwellian. If you're reviewing sensitive information, so if you're looking at maybe you are concerned you have a heart disease or something, and all of a sudden your insurance premiums get jacked up because the advertising agency sold that information, then that's not really fair to you. So free speech, not every country allows for open discourse. Obviously, the United States, we have an amendment for that. But even with free speech, it's easier to voice controversial opinions with anonymity. Just because we have free speech doesn't mean somebody can't punch you in the face for saying it. And then there's this argument of I've got nothing to hide, which I think is kind of problematic because what's normal now isn't necessarily normal in the future. And as those goalposts shift, you might find yourself in an area where you're no longer, maybe you do have something to hide for one reason or another. Here's some incentives to de-anonymize users. So targeted advertising, there's a multi-billion dollar industry built around this, and it's fairly developed and robust at this point. Is a huge ecosystem. I got a headache just from looking at a diagram of where all your data goes. The conversation of banned or taboo topics. So maybe in some countries this is about sexuality with porn bans, adult content bans. And you want to link actions to a person. So generally this comes about when you're trying to link maybe somebody Googled ball bearings and pressure cookers. And you want to find out who that is for obvious reasons. So here's some real-life cases of people getting compromised, or their anonymity compromised. So Freedom Hosting, I think this was back in 08, I don't remember exactly. They hosted a lot of illegal content, so the feds compromised the servers, and there was a vulnerability in Firefox at the time that was what the Tor browser was using. So they had all of the users' browsers phone home with a real IP and MAC address. Dread Pirate Roberts, I think Ross Ulbricht, got compromised. Because he used a real email with a Stack Overflow account and then took code and just from Stack Overflow and just put it straight into Silk Road. And then the feds found him through that trail and then they tackled him in a library with his laptop open. And then Cebu, I might be pronouncing that wrong, but he was a member of LulzSec and he logged into IRC just once without Tor and that was enough for the feds to figure out, or they at least got enough of an idea they could start honing in on him. So how are users tracked? So cookies, advertisers using cookies. So if you have an advertisement on multiple sites with like Google AdSense, then it's possible for them to see where you're going, and they have a huge back-end databases where they can do a bunch of comparisons and figure out, even with the same origin policy, they can't necessarily see other things, but they can link it all together, and they can work with other advertising agencies. Website fingerprinting, so the webpage can just fingerprint your version, version of your browser and your OS, your battery level. These were all put in there for developers as a way to do like convenient things like power saver mode, but we can use them for tracking. And then unique GPU bleed, which is kind of cool. You can really narrow down a browser by using this because it's just hardware defects, so there's really no way to prevent this other than just stripping your GPU every time you use the internet like Mr. Robot. And then man in the middle, the ISP can see your logs, the government can subpoena them from the ISP, or they can just sit in the middle, the guy in the coffee shop can see them. And then how do we achieve anonymity? So assume the website's perfectly secure, and an adversary is sitting on the wire, we're in a coffee shop or something. Even if the contents of the traffic are obfuscated with HTTPS, it doesn't really matter because they can just see we're looking at the beginner's guide to tax evasion or something like that, and they can make a pretty educated guess about what you're doing. So now we can introduce a proxy in the middle as kind of a measure to prevent this. This is kind of the concept of a VPN or a mixed network. So if we connect to a middle server that'll mix our traffic in with others, assuming the mix is secure, because obviously if the mix gets hacked, then it's trivial. So if they don't, if they're between the server and us, then they don't know who the destination is, and then we're anonymous. And if they're between the server and the destination, they don't know whose traffic it is. And this is kind of a nice graphic to see exactly how that works. So you just have source destination or source anonymity and destination anonymity, and the traffic's unlinkable. But this is kind of, it can be easy to defeat. So users can defeat themselves if you just access your own Facebook profile and they can see what profile that is. Now they know who you are. Cookies might not contain private information, but they can be used to track you across sites, especially if you use it and then you hop off the VPN and that cookie appears. Now they know that's your cookie. And then statistical inference. So if one user is sending a lot of traffic, so if there's 2 gigabytes going to Google, and no other website, and you're sending 2 gigabytes to a VPN, then it's a pretty good guess that you're sending stuff to Google. And then if the server just is a bad implementation, uses like queues or stacks or something like that, then the adversary can use that server and see that, so they can just tell, okay, well, these packets went out in this order, and these users sent these packets in this order, so we know who's using them. And if there's only a few users, there's a small anonymity set, like I mentioned earlier, and if the mix waits for like X amount of traffic to avoid this, then maybe you wait 3 days before your traffic gets sent out. And if you're trying to text your friend that you're on your way to airliner, then it's kind of pointless. So here's some data that we really want to conceal to become anonymous. So PII, browser information, IP address, how much data we're sending, and timing and patterns, since some traffic has different patterns, like a streaming service versus a website or a forum. So we can differentiate between the two. So now we can introduce the idea of onion routing. So the idea, it might be a little hard to see the graphic, but the idea is that we're going to take our message and we're going to wrap it in 3 layers of encryption, and then we'll negotiate an encryption with each router along the way. We'll pick 3. So the first router can only see the outer layer of encryption, and it'll undo that, and it can see where it should go next. And then the next one will see the next layer of encryption, strip it, send it to the final link. Then the final link will strip off that final layer of encryption and then send it to its destination. But it's important to note that the first router can see where it's coming from, and the last router can see where it's going. So if you're not using encryption on that last packet, if you're not using HTTPS or whatever, then they can see that. And then this is from the EFF about how TOR works specifically. We'll talk about this more in a second, but basically, it negotiates. You have the 5 relays there, and Alice's TOR client, I should say, picks those 3 relays and puts traffic through those. And everything but that last link is encrypted, which is why it's the red arrow, since the exit node can see that traffic. So like I mentioned, it picks a circuit. It's an entry node, a middle node, and an exit node. 3 layers of encryption, 1 for each node. And then each node will decrypt the layers as they go through, like an onion. So the entry node sees the sender, the exit node sees the decrypted message. What's that? Yeah. It was a revelation for me. So how do we find our entry and exit nodes? So entry nodes are just all on a public list, or not all of them are, but a lot of them are on a public list. So you can just look this up anywhere. Anyone can see this, including sensors, which is important. And in order to be an entry node, you do have to have constant uptime or consistent uptime, and you have to be vetted by the Tor community. So generally, you'll serve as like a middle node for a little while, show that you can handle traffic and that you're not doing anything shady. And exit nodes are the same, but you have to volunteer to run an exit node, and that's because if you run an exit node, all that traffic is traced to you. So if I try to DOS some website, you're responsible for that as far as that website is concerned, which is an issue. I think people have done studies where they ran a Tor node and they got like 2 million complaints in like 2 months or something. So you do have to volunteer to run that, and it's not for the faint of heart. So how do we choose circuits? How often should we choose them? So the idea here is that when we choose a circuit, if it's alive for a long time and we pick bad nodes that are controlled by an attacker, then it's less likely that we'll pick an attacker since we're not picking as often. But if we do pick an attacker, then we are kind of screwed because we're hooked in with them for so long. And if it's alive for a short time, then there won't be as much damage done, but you're a lot more likely to pick an attacker. So the default circuit lifetime is 10 minutes. You can change that if you want to, but I think there's been some math done on this kind of the sweet spot with the size of the Tor network at the moment. But there's a problem with relay selection. Not really a problem inherent with Tor, but just kind of necessary evil. The relays are chosen off of bandwidth. Turns out governments can offer a lot of bandwidth, so it's possible for them to kind of influence the probability of them being chosen by just offering a ton of bandwidth. And then they might have a better likelihood of getting chosen. So a lot of attacks on the Tor network, their problem is that we can't trust relays or users or the infrastructure because it's all volunteer, and everyone's anonymous or pseudo-anonymous at least. So first we have multiple vantage point attacks. So the idea here is that if an attacker manages to get the entry and the exit node, then you're kind of screwed. It's probabilistic. It's it's a lot more unlikely than a single vantage point attack. But the idea is that they can just set up a signaling method. So if they see your traffic come through the first node, and then if they see that traffic come through your exit node or their exit node, then now they know. Or they can devise a signaling method to say this is the same traffic, and then that flow will continue. They can continue to track that, and they can see where it's coming from and where it's leaving. So now they have compromised you. And this can be hard to do because obviously it's expensive to process that many packets. But a single vantage point is a lot more achievable. You only have to be chosen for an exit or an entry node. It's still probabilistic, but it's a much easier thing to do. So traffic analysis. Some websites have a very specific traffic pattern. Like I said earlier, a streaming service might be kind of a constant stream. A forum may just be choppy every time you load a page. So Tor pads traffic to work around this, makes all the traffic from every website look the same. Or not every website, but it has some preset patterns. So the problem with this flow is that we have three websites, and we can tell which website generated that trace because it's the same or roughly the same. So what Tor does is just pads all that traffic to varying degrees to say it's much harder to identify which website it's from. And as long as they can't guess with better than random chance plus like some fuzz factor, then we're fine with this. So correlation attacks are kind of even scarier because you don't need to be chosen as a Tor node in order to do these. So if you're using a forum that timestamps their messages and your adversary has access to your usage logs, so if they're government, complicit ISP, whatever, then they can show that you have been online every single time that this person posts a comment, you've been online, and every single time you come home from work or whatever, that person posts a comment 5 minutes later or their user goes online, then that may not be enough to sentence you or search you, but it is definitely enough to pique their interest. There have been cases where people have, I think, sat in surveillance vans and just said, okay, well, this Tor traffic come from this house every time he comes home at 5 p.m., so we can maybe get a search warrant from a judge for that. And obviously, that's kind of specific active monitoring, but if they're already suspicious of something, then... So now I'll talk about censorship. So censorship is just when anything gets blocked, any content, really. So in America, it's unconstitutional, and there's limits to this. You can't infringe on the rights of others, and private platforms can do whatever they want. There's been a lot of issues with deplatforming lately. on Twitter and Facebook. Other nations don't forbid it, though, and some actually put it in a written law that they can do it, and others just kind of do it behind the scenes. So we're going to look at three censorship methods, but one method that kind of goes above all that is just don't give people internet. In Iran, I think it's been shown that less than 8% of people have access to high-speed internet, so they pretty much only give government workers and academics access to high-speed internet. I think they give them, like, kilobytes per second. So it basically makes it impossible to do anything. You can't stream videos. You can't download things efficiently. I mean, some modern chat services take up that much bandwidth. I'm sure Slack takes up a gigabyte just sitting there at a cafe, so... So at the network layer, we're just going to look at the four-layer model. The seven-layer model is a little overkill for this. So IP blocking, this is kind of the simplest form of censorship. So just blacklist an IP address. So if it's on the Tor public registry, just don't serve to it. If you don't want people going to Google's DNS server, just block 8.8.8.8. So it's cheap and it's really easy to implement. But the problem with this is that with NATing, you can get a lot of IP addresses behind one service. So you block one CloudFront or cloud hosting IP address, and all of a sudden, you've killed a bunch more hosts that aren't targeted. And it's really easy to check. You can just run a trace route. And then when it gets dropped at some node along the way, you know where you're getting censored. Then you can route around it or try to. And then keyword filtering, another pretty simple way. So just detect blacklisted keywords. You can do this with like regex or just straight searches. But you can kind of map out the rules of this. If anybody's done a lot of work with AI, there's models where you can map out the rules of a given AI. I couldn't tell you more than that. But it is possible to do, so you can kind of work around it, see what gets blocked, and then start implementing things like dog whistles. The intuition there being that you just use something like a dog whistle that humans can't hear. And that's been a really big thing, again, with the content moderation battles on Twitter and Facebook. People using just secret words that aren't really so secret to maybe everyone else, but to the AI systems they are. So at the transport layer, BGP route poisoning. So BGP is just used to route traffic between ASs. If you don't already know what it is, and ASs are just all the different segments of the internet. So your ISP has one. So there's not a whole lot of trust in the BGP protocol. They tried to implement BGP-SEC, but that's expensive, and people don't like spending money. So any AS owner can advertise a route to a subnet prefix, and we route by the most specific prefix. So if you advertise a slash 24 and I advertise a slash 26, then they're going to choose that slash 26. And by advertising a more specific route, you can just black hole all that traffic, or you can route it to fake places. And in 2008, Pakistan tried to censor a YouTube video. I don't remember what it was, but they told Pakistan Telecom to give a BGP route announcement for those specific IP addresses. But they actually advertised way too specific, and then all of the traffic for YouTube just got routed to them and got black holed. So I think YouTube was down for like 4 hours. And then YouTube had to hijack their own website back through this exact attack. So a lot of ASs won't accept advertisements from untrusted sources. But if it's a government running it, like Pakistan, or there's a complicit ISP, obviously those are trusted entities. Most ASs won't accept advertisements that are more specific than a slash 24. You don't really need more specific in a lot of cases. And it's still a pretty viable attack. This wasn't used for censorship, but I think it's pronounced Eve. Or maybe it's Threve, but they recently did a 3-year hijack where they hijacked a bunch of normal ASs, or they had a bunch of normal ASs. They just ran them normally, gained trust in the network. Then they started hijacking these unused spaces and directing botnets through them to gain ad revenue. I think they made like $3 million, which is just to show that you can still do this stuff. Obviously, it requires a lot more planning, and not just anybody can buy an AS for $100,000 and start blackholing stuff. But so also the transport layer. So the TCP resets just kill the connection. So if you see a connection that you don't like going through, just send a reset, and the connection will die. And these are hard to get around because they're used by, I think it's about 20% of the internet of websites will close a connection with an RST. And so you can't really treat it as a malicious thing. So they're used by the Great Firewall of China, or at least they were at some point. It's just cheap and it's easy. It's pretty obvious. You know that your TCP stream just got killed. But if you use IPsec, that's authenticated. So not just anybody can start injecting stuff into your stream and killing the connection. But again, it's just really cheap and easy way to just kill a connection if you don't like it. And at the application layer, so when you resolve the domain name of an IP address, you make a query to a DNS server. And if you make a query for a censored domain, then the sensor can just inject a fake DNS response into the stream. And since they're sitting before the DNS server in a lot of cases, they can race the DNS server, serve you a fake IP address. And DNS is also unauthenticated to some degree, so this response can be trusted. So this is kind of what it looks like. So you make a, it has the classic guy in the hoodie instead of a government, but if you make a request to the DNS server, then the attacker just says, okay, no, I'm this name server. Here you go. Here's the IP address. And then now your cache has been poisoned, so in some cases at least. So now every time you make that query, you're going to go to that website. So DNSSEC's authenticated, so you can't just spoof responses. It's kind of the same as the IPsec. DNS hold-on's another implementation that will, it'll wait briefly, and then if you get multiple responses back, then it'll just wait and take action. There's several different ways it'll take action. Sometimes it'll just scream at you and say something's going on, or it'll make the query again. And then just don't allow DNS entries to live forever, so that even if you do get poisoned, then it doesn't just sit there forever, and every time you try to go to Google, you end up going to whatever malicious site you're going to. So we've got this concept of collateral damage, which is kind of the key concept in censorship and evading censorship. So there has to be a disincentive for the censor to block your traffic, and this is often done by either mimicking a really unused protocol or a custom protocol, because they may be hesitant to block that, because they block a custom protocol, all of a sudden the VoIP for your entire company is knocked out, and they're getting screamed at by Cisco or whoever. Or if you try to block, you can't really just block HTTP for an entire country. It just doesn't work. You can drop all HTTPS traffic, though, which I can't think of who actually did that for a while, but some countries just won't let you use HTTPS and force you to use HTTP. So how does Tor actually achieve this? So since the registry is public, censors have access to it. So Tor maintains a private list of bridges, and if you need one, you can contact them, and they'll give you a list of them. And they leak these out very slowly so that a government can't just send a million emails from different accounts and get them all. But then they won't be able to blacklist all of them at once, so people in censored nations will be able to get access to them. And how do we cause collateral damage to this? So it's really not difficult to identify Tor traffic. The idea isn't to make it difficult. So it's very easy to pick out Tor traffic. So if you're trying to browse Reddit at work on Tor, then you're probably still going to get caught. But they have these things called pluggable transports, which essentially they transform the traffic so that it doesn't look like Tor. I think the most popular one right now is OBS-T4. I might be mixing up some letters there, but basically it just mixes up the traffic, makes it look looks like something else. Usually they try to mimic HTTP because, again, you can't just block HTTP. So Meek is a really common solution, which has kind of had some trouble recently, but the idea is that you send a request to a cloud hosting domain, and then that request is going to go through to Cloudflare or whoever, and then they'll unpack the request, and then they'll see where you want that traffic actually to go, and it'll go to this censored website. But pretty recently, at least China, I don't know about any other nations doing it, but China said, look, we're not going to serve, or we're not going to let you operate here. I think they said this to Microsoft, Google, and I think they it might have been Cloudflare too. Sorry, and Amazon. And they said, if you do this, we're not going to serve you. We're not going to make deals with you. So I think Microsoft's the only one that actually lets people do this anymore, because there's just very little economic incentive to do this when you're losing out on the entirety of business from China. So how do you actually download Tor? I was going to do a demo, but it almost seemed redundant because they have made this. The Tor project is amazing, and they've made it just so simply easy. So Windows and Linux and OS X all have installers. With Linux, you don't even need to install it. You just untar it and then run it. So you just fire it up after you download it and install it, and you just give it like 5 seconds. Some people have been caught before because they didn't give it enough time, and they just started Googling stuff, or I guess DuckDuckGoing stuff, and got caught for that. But it'll tell you when you're connected, and it'll give you a thing to actually test your connection, make sure you're on Tor. But again, it's like so easy to use that if you just browse through that link, then you have already installed Tor. And what if you can't download Tor because you're in a censored country? So censors block Tor nodes, so why don't they just block the Tor project? So Tor does offer a service where you can contact them, and they'll give you an alternative method of downloading it with a mirror or something like that. They also make it really easy to run off a USB, so you can distribute it locally. Obviously, this isn't ideal, but and they currently offer support in English, Chinese, Farsi, if that tells you anything about kind of the people who are most in need of this. And then really quick, like the end of here, just going to touch on Tails. So Tails is the Amnesiac online or Amnesiac Incognito live system. So it comes preloaded with a lot of common software. Everything goes through Tor. It's got some crypto wallets, like NoScript, email clients. I think it's Proton or Raptor or something. And Tails runs in memory. So on shutdown, it just leaves nothing behind. Doesn't even use the swap space on your disk. And you can choose to save it to disk. And then when you wipe it, it'll actually wipe it, overwrite it with junk data, and then wipe it again. Otherwise, the bits would just still be sitting there on the disk. But some problems with Tails is it's kind of foreboding. Obviously, if you're part of the InfoSec community, it's probably not. But if you're just trying to figure out how to learn to use PGP and put an OS on a flash drive, it can be kind of be scary to use, which is kind of the goal of the, which is why Tor is, they've made it so easy to install, because the idea is just anybody should be able to do it. And it's only amnesiac if you can shut it down in time. So like I said earlier, the original Dread Pirate Roberts got caught because they just staged a fight in a public library right behind him and then tackled him, and then they had access to the keys to the kingdom. So this is kind of a problem, but again, it's kind of if they already have their eye on you. And then really quick, some OPSEC stuff, just one slide on it, but technology can get you very far. Human error will still ruin the strongest security. I forget what this was in relation to, but it did happen. So it doesn't matter if you use Tor or whatever, but if you're going to publish your home address and your PGP key online, it doesn't really matter. So a big thing is not reusing account names and email addresses. A lot of really prominent people have got caught doing these things. They use one account somewhere. They use the same account name somewhere else on like a hacking forum. Then on Stack Overflow, they use their real name, something like that. And you have to use these tools every single time, which is a problem for some people because, like I said earlier, if you log in with IRC without Tor once, it's enough. And then don't use personally identifiable services while you're anonymous. So if you have Tor in one window and Gmail in another that's not on Tor, those activity logs still correlate. So Google's still going to tell whoever, yeah, they were on Google at this exact, or they're on Gmail at this exact same time from this exact same IP address. Yeah, so that's it. If there are any questions. A little abrupt, but yeah. I couldn't think of a good conclusion. Yeah, so it's just entirely a volunteer network. They get funding through like the EFF. A lot of human rights groups fund them. All the nodes are run through volunteers. Like I said, the government runs a bunch of them, which is very nice in a paradoxical way. Yeah, that's pretty much it. It's just there's a lot of donations, community-driven efforts. It's kind of the same as Linux in a sense. Yeah. Yeah, pretty much. Yes, exactly. That's kind of the problem with it is that there's not a whole lot of incentive to host it unless you're just a volunteer, but there's a lot of incentive for governments to host them. So they do, and that's why we really aim to make it as hard as possible for a government to get into that trusted position. But like I said earlier, governments can offer a lot of bandwidth. They have nothing but time, so they can just sit there. And I think it's kind of important to know that when you're using Tor, because otherwise, I think a lot of people, it's kind of like a ethereal word, so they kind of just assume I hit button and I'm good. Yeah, and if you don't want to use Firefox, I think there's a Tor browser, and then there's a Tor program that you can use to funnel whatever traffic you want through the Tor network. So you don't have to use the Tor browser. It's just kind of it's just easy. Everything's already set up, and you know it works. But there are plenty of ways. I think it supports a lot of protocols. I don't exactly know which ones off the top of my head, but you can just use Tor instead of using Firefox if there's a bunch of like CVEs sitting out there waiting to get you. It varies a lot. Generally, it's not super viable to do things like you're probably not going to want to stream Netflix over it, because maybe you should because of they've been leaking everyone's data pretty recently. But it's not really feasible to do things like that. But if you're just browsing a forum, I think it usually adds. I saw there was a study that did, they did a lot of math on this, but it's usually like about 5 to 10 seconds of overhead. And I think for a lot of users who are just starting out, it's kind of frustrating. But when you show them, like, it's actually jumping from each node to node, doing all this encryption and onion routing, it's a little bit more understandable. But yeah, it's still perfectly usable for just like normal bursty HTTPS traffic. It's those long streams that kind of get you with the overhead. No, generally it's the governments aren't about to tell TOR that. So unless they have some proof, and even in that case, they may be reluctant to shut it down just because that's where they get their infrastructure. Yeah. Oh. Yeah. So you have to volunteer to be an exit node. They will not volunteer you. I don't know the exact process. As like I said, they're vetted in the TOR community, but that's kind of a magical phrasing. As far as I know, it's people who are active in the TOR community, public figures, people who are large advocates of privacy. But obviously, it's not possible. Sometimes they'll get through the cracks. That's why I think usually you see more entry than exit nodes. Yeah, I think the problem is that you kind of trouble offering like high bandwidths with an IoT device network, since like your Nest camera is probably not going to be pumping out like gigabit speeds of. Oh, sure, yeah.